Marc Esserman was a former student of mine whom I judged as particularly skilled at chess. But he had a brain for other activities. He was a very, very intelligent young man, and he had a very cheerful disposition.
So we start, Marc Esserman is playing white, and Viswanathan Anand is playing black. So Marc Esserman makes the first move. He goes pawn e4.
And now Anand plays a Sicilian.
He plays...
not the healthy Sicilian, but the Sicilian. c3. Anand decides to take the gambit, right?
Okay. Well, he goes knight f6.
Right.
Attacking the e4 pawn.
Now d e5, right?
Pawn e5.
Knight d5.
Knight d5.
And now pawn takes pawn.
Knight f3.
Knight f3, okay. So he's not exactly rushing to grab his pawn back, because the pawn on d4 is pinned anyway, since the knight on d5 would be lost if black captures on c3.
Right.
So what did Anand play? All right, now...
pawn e6.
Now white played what? Queen takes?
Pawn takes pawn.
Okay.
And black responds with pawn d6. Bishop c4. And then knight c6.
Okay.
And white castles.
White castles. White has gained some superiority by the fact that I think black has played erroneously in this situation already.
Black plays bishop e7, and white plays queen e2. Black castles.
No, I think castle is a mistake.
For black.
I always talk about early mistakes. A lot of people are anxious to castle in a situation where they can simply castle because they can. And the rule about castle, if you must, castle if you desire to, but do not castle simply because you can. People seem to get a thrill at the one move in chess where you move two pieces at one and the same move is castling. So people get a thrill out of that, and so they castle quickly. Now, if you notice, white's pieces are already ready to fire at the black castle. The bishop on c4 is going to pull back to d3, and every piece of white is ready to concentrate on the attack of the black king, which has very few pieces defending itself, okay? The queen on d8 and the bishop on e7 are the only pieces there, and they may not survive. The rook doesn't count because it sort of blocks the king from escaping in that direction of the rook. So. Black already has some problems he's given himself, and he doesn't seem to understand that. So what happened after that?
Black takes the pawn. Yeah, pawn d6 takes pawn e5, then pawn d4 for white, takes pawn d5. So now
e5,
white has a deep pawn, e5.
Now
pawn
what's happened
d4
is,
takes pawn e5.
White has achieved a position similar to the French defense where Nimzowitsch suggested that because of the pawn on e5 limiting the movements of the black minor pieces, especially around the area of the black king, is limited. So now white is ready to line up with queen e4, bishop to d3, threatening mate, and then creating an attack, as you shall see, begins to build. Okay, so what happens next?
He takes the knight here, knight takes knight, and the pawn takes the knight. Then he plays queen c7.
All right, very good.
And then white plays queen e4.
All right.
Black plays rook d8. All
right.
And white plays rook e1.
Right, just simply, as Nimzowitsch said, overprotect the forward pawn, because that pawn is really limiting, needs to be preserved because it's limiting black's pieces.
He plays pawn g6. Right,
he's anticipating bishop to d3, which would be threatening mate. Mm-hmm. All right, so white now plays h4.
Oh, no. Bishop g5.
All right, that is a very fine move, because the trade of the dark squared bishop on e7 takes away or deprives black of defenses on the dark squares, whereas the pawn on e5 still controls f6, and g5 is already a strong post for the knight, and as you'll see, white will then control more by playing h4 to guarantee control of the dark squares and start a possible penetration into those dark squares to create a mating attack.
Bishop takes bishop, knight takes bishop.
I'm not sure bishop takes bishop is a good move. Probably he should play either b6 or if he can. Maybe it works, bishop to e6, mm-hmm. bishop to d7, and either you win the queen for rook and bishop in some way, or use the white black bishop to go to c6 after bishop takes e7, knight takes, followed by bishop to e6, which is very important to start to use some of the control, extra control of the light squares, and use the knight on e7 to go to f5 to control dark squares around the king.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, black is going to be in grave trouble. So, okay. Black didn't do that. He just decided to play
on
h6, which weakens the king position entirely.
White moves knight back to f3. Black plays queen e7.
Really, this hoping that this reputation, a draw by reputation, will be achieved.
Reputation, yeah. As opposed to reputation.
That's right.
Now he plays pawn h4.
All right. Now the threat is to really play h5, and now the g6 cannot stay there, and so if pawn to g5, then bishop to d3 will create mating attack.
Mm-hmm. So now he plays knight a4. Five, attacking the bishop. And bishop d3. Anything from here?
I think really in this position black is already lost. And soon, for some reason, white concedes to a repetition of moves because he's playing a former world champion and therefore he was satisfied with the draw. I think he lost his. I think my friend Esserman lost his objectivity and his ambition to beat a world champion when he has an opportunity that's golden in this position. But what can you say?
So black plays bishop d7, and what would you, if you were playing instead of Esserman playing, because here he decided to repeat the position, because it went bishop. Yeah, bishop d7, and then from here they started to repeat back and forth, moving their knights. From here they went back and forth with their knights, and it became a draw. So what would you play? But what would you play if you were playing this position?
H5 is strong, and queen e3 is strong. Even this is a good move.
What would black play in response? What if they did this kind of thing? Bishop c6, they play here.
This is probably good.
Rook e3. Really just that. Queen, king g7.
Maybe just go here.
Rook, and now black doesn't have much. Has to defend, I guess, or something, right? Okay, so the knight comes out there to attack the bishop. So now let's say black moves.
Two, three, four, five pieces in the attack. This is not much of a piece, and the queen and the rook.
Bishop there or something. There's not much for black to do. So bishop d5.
Place still have to worry about pulling here.
Yeah, that's not good. So instead of their back, but even back is bad. Because black's position, just, there's nowhere for it to go but down.
Threatening bishop takes pawn.
So you just need to slowly build an attack. You don't even need to. Yeah, so there's nothing for black. What can black really do here? They're too cramped to really do much of anything. Yeah, no, this is not good. Rook.
Even this and this is coming up.
Rook here. There's not much here.
Here and here.
And then the king goes back.
Mm-hmm.
To
F8. All right, let's go. Can we go here?
And now... knight c6. There. Yeah. Yeah, because even if you try to block it out, it's a6. Yeah. And if black plays this instead... blocking out the knight.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, we could. King e8. This just seems like a hopeless position for black. They just keep getting crushed and crushed and crushed.
Yeah, I mean, my goodness.
You can't.
We're here. Pawn takes, or rook takes, or queen takes. Queen takes even good. I can come in around this way, the back door maybe.
And then bishop here.
Well,
but he's kind of lost.
I can just take that and play queen
b6. There's not much here. So just by the nature of the position, black can't move around. They don't have movement to do anything, is what you're saying. So white just slowly builds it up and just takes the control of the territory.
Well, queen here even.
To b6? Yeah.
Just keep. Switch the rook over to here soon. There's a threat to win a pawn you were in already on this side of the board.
So maybe queen here. D7.
This jack has meaning.
And then king here. Yeah. Instead, he moved the knights back and forth and just took a draw. So it's interesting to see the analysis of someone who's had much experience with this kind of thing and see how they handle this kind of position.
Marc Esserman. He didn't hit the mark.
So what's the moral of the story here?
Moral of the story, you should play it out when you have a shot at beating the world champion. Well, so if you lose, so what? What do you lose? Nothing.
That's it.
I mean, you're supposed to beat a world champion when you have the winning position. I mean, I was forced to take a draw by my team captain against Botvinnik. It's silly. How ridiculous. So that the U.S. could boast that we have 4 draws against the Soviet Union. They won the tournament anyway, and we finished 5th or 6th anyway.
All right, well, that was this game.